Yashodanandana Vraja Janaranjana. Yashodanandana Vraja Janaranjana. Yamunatira Vanachari. Yamunatira Vanachari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jai Gopi Jana Vallabha Girivara Dhari. Yashodanandana Vraja Janaranjana. Yamunatira Vanachari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Radha Madhava Radhe. Jaya Radha Gopinath Radha Gopinath Radhe. Jaya Shri Gopal Shri Gopal Shri Gopal Jaya Shri Gopal. Jaya Gauranitai, 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 Jaya Gauranitai. Jai Jai Prabhupada, Prabhupada. Prabhupada, Jaya Jaya Prabhupada. Nittai Gaur Haribol, 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 Nittai Gaur Haribol.
Jai Om Vishnupad, Bhavansh Parajar, Ashtotara Sadishimat, Esi Bhaktivedanta Swami Shila Prabhupada Ki. Jai Om Vishnupad, Bhavansh Parajar, Ashtotara Sadishimat, Bhakti Siddhanta Sarasthakur Maharaj Shila Prabhupada Ki. Ananta Koti Vaishnavrind Ki. Grantrat Srimad Bhagavat Mahapurana Ki. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11,
chapter 27, entitled The Process of Deity Worship, text number 9. Acharyam standi legnova. Acharyam standi legnova. Surye vap suhridi dvaja. Surye vap suhridi dvaja. Dravyena bhakti yuktorchet. Dravyena bhakti yuktorchet. Swagurum mama mayaya. Swagurum mama mayaya. Acharyam standi legnova. Surye vap suhridi dvija. Dravyena bhakti yuktorchet. Swagurum mama mayaya. Acharyam standi legnova. Surye vap suhridi dvija. Dravyena bhakti yukto. Dravyena bhakti yukta uccha. Acharyam standi legnova. Surya vap suhridi dvija. Matajis. Swakuru mama mahaya. Archayam standi legnova. Archayam. Within the deity form, standile, in the earth, agnao, in fire, va, or, surye, in the sun, va, or, apsu, in water, hridi, in the heart, dvija, the brahmana, dravyena, by various paraphernalia. Bhakti yuktaha, endowed with devotion. Archet, he should worship. Swagurum, his worshipable Lord. Mam, me. Amayaya, without any deception. Translation. A twice-born person should worship me, his worshipable Lord, without duplicity, offering appropriate paraphernalia in loving devotion to my deity form, or to a form of me appearing upon the ground, in fire, in the sun, in water, or within the worshipper's own heart. There is no purport, we'll continue further. One should first purify his body by cleansing his teeth and bathing. Then one should perform a second cleansing by smearing the body with earth and chanting both Vedic and Tantric mantras. Fixing the mind on me, one should worship me by his various prescribed duties, such as chanting the Gayatri mantras at the three junctures of the day. Such performances are enjoined by the Vedas and purify the worshipper of reactions to fruitive activities. The deity form of the Lord is said to appear in 8 varieties: stone, wood, metal, earth, paint, sand, the mind, or jewels. Purport by the disciples of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Srila Jiva Goswami explains that certain deity forms, such as those made of sand, are manifested for a brief time to fulfill a personal desire of the worshipper. Those, however, who desire to attain pure love of God should worship the permanent form of the deity, made, for instance, of marble, gold, or brass, and they should maintain continual worship. In Krishna consciousness, there is no scope for neglecting the worship of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Om Ajnanti Mirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Nama Shri Chaitanya Manobishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yutaha Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Ragunatam Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakanvitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindubhyaye Vacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadigar Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna. I'd like to welcome all of you to today's Sunday morning Bhagavatam class. We are in the 11th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, discussing a very interesting and a very, very important section, which is famously known as the Uddhava Gita. This section of the Bhagavatam is the section where Lord Krishna is personally instructing us on a very deep message. This is also known as the second Gita of Krishna. The Gita that was spoken to Arjun was more philosophical and crisp. This one is a little more elaborate and devotional, deep. The purposes are different, the context is different, the situation is different. Here there is no emergency, you know. So therefore, the principles that Krishna is speaking about Uddhava is very different. Look at the discussion here. At this point, Krishna is speaking about deity worship. He's talking about how important it is to worship deities. And he's going into elaborate discussions of what type of deities to worship, how the process of deity worship has to be done carefully and all that. This is like an entire chapter on deity worship. Obviously, Krishna didn't speak this to Arjun, because where was his opportunity to worship deity in the battlefield, right? So his approach towards the message was very different when Krishna spoke. There, Krishna spoke about worshipping him by performing duties. So Krishna's message varies according to the situation in which the message is given. It doesn't mean that it's different messages. It just means that the context is different now. So many times when I hear words of Krishna like this in the Bhagavatam, especially in this context, I am very inclined towards a very interesting comparison that whatever Krishna speaks, wherever he speaks, whether it is the Bhagavad Gita, whether it is Uddhava Gita, the Anu Gita, anytime Krishna speaks, his words carry a lot of power. His words carry a lot of depth, lot of power. But if you analyze his actions with his words, you will not find them to be very consistent, you know. He speaks one thing, but he does something else, you know. So I always tell people, don't analyze Krishna's actions. If you want to analyze actions, analyze Ram's actions. So Krishna's words and Ram's actions are perfectly in sync. So what we are going to do now is this concept of deity worship, which Krishna is speaking to Uddhava here in the Uddhava Gita, we are going to see how Ram applies it in the Ramayana. And the interesting thing is that just a lot of people feel Ramayana is not exactly a devotional book. A lot of people have this misunderstanding that Ramayana is a lot about leading, about leadership and things like that, the practical aspects of governance. But actually, Ramayana is as much a devotional book as Bhagavat, if you see it from the right perspective. Just like the Bhagavatam, we have the Navida Bhakti, and each limb of the nine process of devotional service represented by different devotees. Similarly, the Ramayana has the nine limbs of devotional service represented by different devotees. Each limb is represented by one personality. Like Shravanam is represented by Hanumanji, Kirtanam is represented by Valmiki Muni, so on and so forth. And one of the people who represents Archanam is Shabari. So when we are going to discuss this context of deity worship, let me put the connections in place first. The first connection is that, you know, we said words of Krishna can be seen through actions of Ram. The Bhagavad Gita, the Ramayana is the best commentary on Bhagavad Gita. If somebody wants to know what is the best commentary on Krishna's words, the Ramayana is the best commentary. You don't need any better commentary than that. And if you really want to analyze another point of view, why are we talking about Shabari when we're talking about deity worship? When we sing the Mangalarti every day in the morning, Samsara Dava prayers, if you actually study, we are standing in front of the deities and we're singing Samsara Dava. But what are we singing about, or who are we singing about? We are not singing about the deities, we are singing about Guru. Vande Guru Charanaravindam. We are singing about the spiritual master. Now what is the connection between singing about spiritual master and doing deity worship? That's what the Ramayana is going to tell us. And Shabari is exactly going to tell us that connection. The connection between deity worship and Guru worship, basically. So, when discussing with Shabari, there are a lot of discussions that happen between Ram and Shabari. I'm going to go a little deeper into these discussions and to the experience of Shabari. Ram, he's talking about the need for simplicity. So simplicity essentially means the need to be same inside and outside. Today, most people are duplicitous. And therefore, you can't trust anybody in this world. And everyone lets down your expectations. So the question is, whom to trust? The Ramayana has this whole interesting episode about Sugriv, who does not trust Ram only. He sends Hanumanji to test if Ram is worth being trusted, you know. And he tells Hanumanji that when you go to Ram and you meet Ram, and he doesn't know it's Ram, but he tells when you go and meet these two people, and when you are sure they are worth trusting, How will you tell me that they were trusting? Because Sugriva was on top of a mountain and Hanumanji is right below talking to Ram and Lakshman. From that distance, how do you give a signal, you know? Obviously, in that time, there was no WhatsApp text to send Hanumanji, you know, everything is clear and things like that. And so Sugriva gave a very simple way of testing or like giving the signal. He said, if you carry Ram and Lakshman on your back, if you carry those two people on your back, that means I will know that they are worth being trusted. Now, why did he say carry them on your back? Because most people, when you say that you have let down your trust, what does it mean? You're stabbed from behind, you know. So most people, they need someone who can guard their backs. You need someone who can guard their backs. That's what a good friend is. A good friend is someone who can protect you from behind, which means even when you're not there, your friend is loyal to you. Even when, you know, in your absence, your friend is loyal to you. So if Hanumanji is carrying Ram on his back, that means he's telling Sugriv, this person will protect your back. Because Valiv can attack from all sides. So Sugriv is aware from the front of attacks, but attacks from the back, he's not aware. So he needs a friend who can protect from behind. And therefore, Shabari here represents complete trust in the words of the spiritual master. In most times, the disciples, when they grow to a certain extent, when they grow beyond a certain point, they think that they're better than the spiritual master. Like for example, there was one story in Kashi of a disciple who became a big scholar, extreme scholar. And when he became such a big scholar, he started traveling around the world, defeating every scholar in the world. And finally, he came back to Kashi. And when he came, he straight went to his guru's ashram. So the guru was very impressed, said, I'm so proud of you that you have defeated all the scholars in the world. And this disciple tells his guru that I have defeated everyone in the world except you. He's telling his own guru, you know, I have defeated everybody except you. And he's telling, because I'm kind on you, I don't want to defeat you, you know. So look at this guy's arrogance, you know. Sometimes what happens is, instead of becoming humble and grateful to the spiritual master, one reflects an attitude of great arrogance. Ravan also had a very similar experience. So now somebody asks Ravan, why did you lift the Kailash mountain? The Kailash mountain is Ravan's worshipable lord, his master, his guru, Lord Shiva's abode. Now, why did Ravan lift the Kailash mountain? So Ravan wanted to show that he can lift his guru also. That means his guru is lighter than him, you know. So essentially, the word guru means heavy. So now, nobody can lift the guru. Lift the guru, essentially, it's not just about physically lifting the guru. A lot of people can physically probably lift the guru, you know. But the question is, can you handle the weight of the guru? For a good disciple should not be proud that I can lift my guru, or I can, you know, prove myself to be stronger than my spiritual master, greater than my spiritual master. And therefore, Ravan, he had a very interesting way of dealing with his spiritual master, with Lord Shiva. Ravan tells Lord Shiva, my dear Lord, I'm too busy. So can you come to my Lanka and accept worship? So I'm too busy to come there all the time to Kailash. Why don't you come here and I will worship you, you know, it'll be easier for me. He's telling Lord Brahma, you are the abode of all Vedic knowledge. So why don't you come to my house and teach me Vedas? So ideally, one should go and sit at the feet of the spiritual master and learn. But nowadays, the idea is to bring spiritual master to your house, you know, and learn like that. So here, Ravan is telling Lord Shiva, come home, you know, and I will worship you at home. He's ready to worship, but he's saying, you come home. You take the trouble of coming all the way. So this kind of arrogance does not really help people connect with Krishna, connect with the spiritual master. And this pride is what becomes the greatest obstacle in one's devotion to the Lord. Lord Ram, when he goes to the Swayamvar of Mother Sita, and he sees that bow lying on that beautiful asana, Ram is so humble, he's asking his guru, Vishwamitra Muni, can I go and see the bow? He tells him, please go. He goes and, you know, circumambulates the bow 3 times. He tells Vishwamitra Muni, can I touch the bow? Vishwamitra Muni says, please touch. And then he tells him, can I pick up the bow? Vishwamitra Muni tells him, please pick up. And in 1 second, he picks up the bow. And while he's stringing it, the bow breaks. So the idea here, why is Ram asking again and again Vishwamitra Muni for permission? Because he wants to show, to lift something as heavy as that bow, Shivadhanush, you need the mercy of the spiritual master. And by the mercy of the spiritual master, heavy things become light to handle. Now, what does bow represent? In the scriptures, bow, weapons, represent knowledge. The sword of knowledge, the weapon of knowledge, it said, right? So, for us, knowledge is very heavy, technically. Normally, knowledge is very, very heavy. Nobody can lift heavy knowledge. Nobody can lift that, the knowledge of the scriptures. But by the grace of the spiritual master, the heaviest of the heavy knowledge becomes light. You can lift it very easily. You can handle it very easily. And that's what Ram shows us, which is the right attitude. So when Ram comes to Pampa Sarovar, which is the abode of Shabari, where Shabari was living, this simple interaction between Shabari and Lord Ram teaches us what is the essence of deity worship and the connection between deity worship and guru worship, basically. So Shabari was an extremely elderly lady, frail, thin, her cheeks had sunken into her, her face, and she was looking extremely dilapidated. But in spite of looking dilapidated and extremely, in that situation, she was looking beautiful. She was looking effulgent. She was wearing a dress that indicated that she was from the Shabara dynasty. And her name Shabari indicated she was the daughter of the leader of the dynasty, basically. And as soon as Ram and Lakshman entered, Shabari immediately made a statement. She said, every word that comes out from the mouth of great devotees always becomes true eventually. And so she said, I have been waiting for you to come from the time my spiritual master has told me this. The moment Shabari spoke those few words, literally, two or three sentences, Ram calls her as Charubhashini. Charubhashini means the one who speaks sweetly. Now, this is the first understanding of deity worship. When you come in front of a worshipable Lord, what do? Speak sweet words of glorification of the Lord. And not just words of glorification of the Lord, when she sees Ram, she's remembering her guru. She's remembering the words of her spiritual master. She's not exactly glorifying Ram over here. She's glorifying her spiritual master's greatness, Ram is calling her Charubhashini. Then he calls her as Tapasvi. And then he calls her as Siddha. And then he calls her as Paricharini. 4 words Ram uses here to describe Shabari. As I said, Charubhashini means the one who speaks sweet words. That means one who offers eloquent poetry, prayers in glorification of the Lord. Tapasvi essentially means one who is able to practice spiritual life without any impediments and without any inconsistencies. And then the word Siddha means she is steady in her practice, and she is steady and doesn't lose patience. A lot of people are excited about spiritual life in the beginning. But as you practice spiritual life, when you realize that I'm not getting exactly the desired result, one starts becoming unsteady. One starts losing patience. And the 4th word he uses to describe Shabari, he calls her as Paricharini, which means Paricharini essentially is talking about worship. The one who is expert in worshiping the Guru and the Supreme Lord. So now, this word Siddha means one who has achieved perfection.
And how does perfection come? Perfection comes by repeated practice. Tiger Woods was once asked this question, how are you so expert? And he said, practice. Beethoven once was composing this, he was singing, and he was giving a performance in front of the Queen of England. And after the whole performance, the Queen of England came and she said, this was outstanding. I've never seen anyone perform this good. And this man says, it took 40 years of 8 hours of practice to be able to perform 1 hour here. 40 years of 8 hours of practice. So what we may say as perfection at one point is a result of a lot of practice. When Ram is calling her Siddha, essentially she's saying you are perfect, but your perfection essentially means that you have practiced enough. And then he calls her as Tapasvi, which means one who understands the power of self-control. Self-control essentially means your mind is wandering away and you're pulling the mind back to where it should be. You're pulling the mind back from where it has gone to where it should be. That's like a tug of war, you know. You're constantly tugging, playing the tug of war of the mind. And the word paricharini here, Ram is saying that you have trust in the words of the spiritual master and patience for those words to manifest. Because the words of the spiritual master don't manifest immediately necessarily, but they manifest eventually. And that gap between hearing the words of the spiritual master and the words manifesting is known as patience. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur gave the instruction to Srila Prabhupada 1922. First time Prabhupada met Bhaktisiddhanta. You speak in the English language in the Western world. And for that instruction to manifest into reality, it became literally 1965, you know. 43 years later, the words of the spiritual master manifested. And when they manifested, we saw the power with which they manifested, basically. The whole Hare Krishna movement is the power of Bhaktisiddhanta's words manifesting 43 years later. Imagine if Prabhupada didn't have the patience to have faith in the words of the spiritual master. Usually, what the spiritual master tells us, we forget in 43 seconds, you know. If you're really, you know, sincere, you forget in 43 minutes. Or if you're really, really, really sincere, 43 days you forget, you know. 43 years Prabhupada didn't forget one instruction of the Guru. That's patience. And that's what the word paricharini essentially means. As I said, Shabari was a beautiful person, not externally. When Lord Ram looked at Shabari, he doesn't look at her from an external point of view, but from the beauty which manifests as a result of bhakti. Now, this beauty of a devotee that manifests is actually the beauty of Bhakti Devi. It's not our beauty. Bhakti Devi is beautiful. And when Bhakti Devi resides in any devotee's heart, that devotee starts looking beautiful. And it's visible, you know. The body is externally may not be beautiful. But when the body is used for the bhajan of the Lord, for the worship of the Lord, then the body actually starts manifesting a beauty. In the Ramayana, we find Shurpanaka, when she comes in front of Lord Ram, externally, she converted her form to look beautiful, externally. But when she changed her form and came to Lord Ram and started telling him that, you're a handsome man, I'm a beautiful girl, why don't we unite? So now, Shurpanaka had got the understanding of beauty wrong completely. So, according to her, beauty was in the from external point of view. But Lord Ram, when he is talking to Shurpanaka, but he's looking at Sita. So Shurpanaka is saying, I am beautiful. But Ram is talking to her, conversing with her, but he's looking at Sita. So if you read this section of the Valmiki Ramayana, it's quite bewildering, you know. I mean, when you're talking to somebody, why would you look at somebody else? It looks actually, quite insulting. But Ram wanted to tell her that you're talking about beauty. You're talking about the beauty which is external in nature. But when I look at Sita, I see beauty that is not just external, but is internal in nature. And that's the beauty that attracts the Lord. That's the beauty that, you know, connects with the Lord. So most people focus on beauty that invokes inferior qualities in us. But bhakti, it focuses on beauty that invokes superior qualities in us. Usually, so the test of beauty is whether it generates sadbuddhi or durbuddhi. So sometimes beauty generates durbuddhi in people, most times. Material beauty generates durbuddhi in people. People have all kinds of wrong thoughts when they see mundane beauty manifesting. But when you see divine beauty manifesting, the thought that you have is never wrong. You actually become sober. When Hanumanji saw Mandodari in Ravan's palace, the moment he saw Mandodari, he was excited that he found Sita. And he was jumping, dancing, kissing his tail, excited, you know, that he found Sita. And then when he actually saw real Sita, he became sober. This is the difference between when you see Maya, when you see Sita. When you see Maya, you become excited. But when you see actual, the Divine Mother, you become sober. So devotion sobers us and material beauty excites us, basically. So Shabari, Ram is calling her by different names. And he calls her as Gajagamini. And he calls her as Prakshamayi. Both these words essentially mean that, so these words are used to address a young, beautiful girl. And here is an elderly lady. She is not young. She is not beautiful exactly. But still, Lord is addressing her in that way because the Lord is looking at her beauty from within. So now, while we are focused on beautifying Krishna, and when we dress the deities and we are focused on beautifying Krishna, what is Krishna focused on? Krishna is focusing on how a devotee is beautiful. So just like we are trying to dress the deity, we are trying to make the Lord look beautiful to the world. What the Lord is also doing is, he is trying to focus on how a devotee is actually beautiful on an internal level. So Shabari, when after these exchange of words, Shabari offers Ram fruits. This is the second level of deity worship. The first level of deity worship is where there is glorification of the spiritual master, glorification of the Supreme Lord by speaking sweet words, charubhashani. And as the devotee is glorifying the Lord's beauty and the Lord's greatness, the Lord's qualities, guna, rupa, nama, the Lord also is glorifying a devotee's qualities, devotee's beauty. So deity worship is reciprocal. As you said, you know, Krishna says, ye yatamam prapadyante stamtateva bhajamiham. Krishna is saying in the Gita, the way you reciprocate with me, I reciprocate with you. If you are focusing on beautifying Krishna, Krishna is focusing on looking at your beautiful qualities. When you are focusing on glorifying Krishna, Krishna is focusing on glorifying your good qualities. That's how deity worship is ye yatamam. And according to the level and the quality with which you beautify Krishna, that much Krishna sees more beauty in you. And according to the quality and the greatness, depth with which you glorify Krishna, Krishna sees that much glorification and appreciation in you. And then the third aspect of deity worship is where she is offering these fruits to Lord Ram. So Ram and Lakshman, they're sitting on a grass mat that she has put down, and they're eating these fruits. Lakshman is looking around and looking at the whole the place. It's spick and span. Usually, when a guest comes to your house, you prefer advance notice. Why? Because the house is normally in a mess. Because normal life is messy, basically. But when special people come, guests come, we like to show that it's great. That life is great, life is beautiful, life is tidy, life is clean. So our manifestation is more of a show than reality. Our cleanliness is more of a show than the reality of what cleanliness is. Our dealings are more of a show than what it is. So if you really want to know who a person is, you should meet that person when nobody is seeing him, or nobody, I mean, he doesn't feel anybody is looking. But that's when the real person is seen, basically. In front of the world, we can easily be great. We can easily show ourselves to be great. Lakshman, when he was looking around, he was saying, we have not given her any notice that we are coming. There was absolutely no form of communication. You know, there was no chance that Shabari will know that they are going to come. He's looking spick and span house, the ashram, spick and span, as if it is just cleaned some time back. Fruits that are chosen are the best quality fruits. A lot of times when devotees speak about this pastime of Shabari giving fruits to Lord Ram, they say that Shabari bit one fruit and gave half to him. Obviously, Valmiki Ramayana doesn't talk about it, because we're talking about deity worship, you know, Archanam. Archanam, we don't, you know, bite and give. Shabari was a high class, you know, and a very, very highly conscious devotee of the Lord. And when you want to identify good fruits in a tree, you don't have to bite every fruit and see, you know. There are ways to identify, you know, when you bite one fruit, and you can actually make out a lot about the quality of all the other fruits also. And she was expert in it. And Lakshman, when he was tasting those fruits, he realized this person has got the best fruits ever possible to pick. Because for the last 13 years, Lakshman has been plucking a lot of fruits. And he knows how difficult it is to get good quality fruits, you know. I mean, for us, we just go to the market and buy fruits, that's all. If you actually go and pluck fruits from trees, you'll understand how difficult it is to find good quality fruits and vary it from the, you know, the not so good qualities. And as Lakshman was eating these fruits, he was saying, this person has really put in efforts. And not just that, freshly made garlands. Now, who makes fresh garlands every day at home, you know? So Lakshman was thinking, how did she know that we're going to come today? And Lakshman, as he was looking at Ram was eating those fruits as if he had never ever eaten fruits in his life. Closing his eyes, meditating on every fruit that he's eating. Focusing intensely, absorbing the taste of every fruit that is being given to him. And Krishna is saying in the Gita, Patram Pushpam Phalam Toyam, Yome Bhaktya Prayajyati, Ashnami Priyatatmana. He says, I will eat it. Here, Ram is actually showing that he actually eats it. And now there are many ways to eat food, you know, and all of us, we have experienced, you know, when you get a home delivery from Swiggy, you know, and you're eating that food. I mean, you cannot compare that with the taste of a mother cooking and, you know, feeding you hot food. Now, when you, obviously, the relish with which we eat prasad that is offered and cooked with great devotion and love is very different from food that is tasty, you know, and cooked hastily, basically. I mean, how can you cook in 23 minutes delivery, you know? It's all very difficult to actually put in devotion in that few minutes, you know. Imagine Shabari here, because she has put in so much devotion in picking up those fruits, when Ram is eating those fruits, he is absorbed every single morsel. When we worship the deities and we offer bhoga to the deities, there are different ways to offer bhoga. One way to offer bhoga is that quick, do the job, you know. Especially at homes, what happens is the deity is like a, you know, aqua guard, you know, purifying machine, food purifier, you know. Lagao bhoga, you know, offering lagao nikalo, ho gaya, purification. You know? And we, obviously, the Lord has to adjust his timings according to our hurry, you know, and our, you know, situation basically. So we treat the Lord as a more or like a food purifying machine, you know, just offer, remove, offer, remove, offer, remove. Where's the question of devotion there, you know? When we cook, when we offer, when we eat, where's the question of devotion there? Sometimes even in the temple, there's so much of hurry that we are trying to offer. Everything on time, on time, on time, on time. Yes, timing is important. But what about the devotion? What about the element of love in it? So here, when Ram is eating this fruits, he is eating as if he has not eaten fruits at all till now. And Lakshman is wondering, I give him fruits every day, you know. I have never seen him meditate like this. I have never seen him absorb his consciousness completely into each fruit like that. And Not just that. In the 14 years of their exile, you know, the 14 years of exile that they were in the forest, Ram appears to be hungry only once in those 14 years. And what was here when he is sitting with Shabari and eating fruits. And he's eating such enormous quantities of fruits. Lakshman is wondering, did he not eat for the last 13 years? You know, he's just eating and eating and eating. Mangoes are very tasty. But you have to go to eat the mangoes at the right season. If you go to eat mangoes at the wrong season, the mangoes will still be there, but they won't be as tasty as, you know, as they should be. So for us to relish the connection when we are in satsang, when we are in, you know, in deity worship, whatever we do, for us to relish what we are doing, there has to be great faith. There has to be great devotion in the heart. And in that, so in seasons of faith, mangoes taste sweetest. So just like, you know, mango, there is a mango season for actually getting good tasty mangoes. In the process of devotional service also, there are many seasons. So we have some seasons where, you know, mangoes don't taste sweet. But the process of bhakti doesn't taste sweet at all. There are, you know, especially when you go through difficulties and, you know, troubles and all, in those seasons, bhakti doesn't taste sweet at all. Rainy season, you know, bhakti doesn't taste sweet. Mangoes don't taste sweet anymore. But when you go in the right season and you pick up the right mangoes, it tastes really, really well. Now, there are two types of rasas. Rasa means juice. And just like there is juice in these mangoes, there is juice in the process of devotional service also. It's known as bhakti ras. And there is something known as vishaya ras. Vishaya ras means juice in mundane pleasures. If you go to these malls, these massive malls, and you look at people around, when they're looking at these different items to buy, you can actually see there's so much juice in their life, you know. They actually feel so alive in those shopping malls. Because they have what is known as vishaya ras, the taste for mundane enjoyment. Unfortunately for us, what happens is, we, when you come to the process of Krishna consciousness, we lose taste for vishaya ras. And we have not got taste for bhakti ras also. So we are neither here nor there, you know. So when you look at these mundane people enjoying themselves like crazy, you wonder what they are enjoying about, you know. And then when you see great devotees enjoying bhakti like crazy, we wonder, how can I ever reach there, you know? So we are somewhere in between. Obviously, Jesus Christ says, either you're hot or you're cold. If you're lukewarm, I spit you out, you know? So either you be this side or be that side. Don't hang around in between for too long, basically. For some time, it's fine. But eventually, we need to go towards developing taste for bhakti. So now, there is a third type of ras, a third type of pleasure, which is known as Brahman ras. So bhakti ras is, you know, when you taste the experience of bhakti ras, one experiences great pleasure. Now, when somebody experiences vishaya ras, mundane pleasures, you know, so somebody who tastes mundane ras, it is never enough for them. How much ever they buy, how much ever they get, it's not enough. It doesn't satisfy you enough. You have to keep hankering for more and more and more. And so the middle path, which is known as Brahman ras. Brahman ras is a path of peace. The yogis, the Buddhists, all these people who are into these, the mood of becoming peaceful, you know, what they're looking for is Brahman ras. Brahman ras doesn't make you run for pleasures. Brahman ras makes you seek peace, satisfaction. So vishaya ras makes you dissatisfied and Brahman ras makes you completely satisfied. But what does bhakti ras do? Bhakti ras simultaneously makes you satisfied and dissatisfied. Simultaneously, it makes you satisfied and simultaneously makes you dissatisfied. For somebody who is very thirsty, what do you do for a thirsty person? How do you help a thirsty person? Give him a glass of water. He drinks one glass of water, thirst quenched. Peaceful, basically. But if you give a fish one glass of water, is it enough for the fish? Hello, a glass. For the fish, one glass is never enough. In fact, you give a whole lake also is not enough. If you give the fish full ocean also is not enough. Because the fish lives in water. Fish needs as much water as possible. So similarly, a devotee is like a fish who is experiencing bhakti ras. Little is not enough. Little more also is not enough. He has to be drowning in bhakti. Only when he is completely immersed in devotion, he feels he is alive. So here, this is not just the case with the devotee. This is the case with Ram also, with the Supreme Lord also. The Supreme Lord simultaneously experiences satisfaction and dissatisfaction when he is dealing with his devotees. When Shabari is feeding him fruits, when he's eating those fruits, he's relishing it. He's experiencing great satisfaction in the heart because he's tasting the love of his devotee. But the problem is, he is not satisfied also simultaneously. How much ever he eats, he feels is not enough only. I need to eat more and more and more. So the problem that we have is also the problem of the Lord. So if you see, what is deity worship? Deity worship is reciprocal, as I said. When a devotee experiences satisfaction, the Lord experiences satisfaction. When a devotee experiences dissatisfaction, the Lord also experiences dissatisfaction. There are many devotees who are like Shabari in the way they worship the Lord. Like, I know so many devotees who are pujaris and who dress the deities. How much ever they dress, it is not enough only. You give them 1 hour, not enough. Give them 2 hours, still not enough. Give them 4 hours, still not enough. They want to do more and more and more. And when they are in that mood of doing more and more and more, the Lord also is in that same mood only. He wants to experience more and more and more, and he wants to reciprocate more and more and more. So here, Archanam, when we're talking about Archanam, we're talking about reciprocation. Just like Shabari put her efforts, put her heart into selecting those fruits and, you know, finding out the best quality of fruits for offering to the Lord also is, and she's not satisfied by getting mediocre. You know, we find this Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's story of what is the name of that devotee whose coconuts? Raghunandan? What's his name? Raghav Pandit, yeah. Raghav Pandit, he would get these coconuts to offer to the Lord, to his worshipable deity. And he'd get these coconuts, and he would get the best coconuts in the whole area. And if those coconuts became a little dirty, I mean, what do you mean by dirty? For us, dirty means rolling on the ground and stuff like that, you know? For Raghav Pandit, the concept of dirt is, if somebody touches the wall and touches their coconut, it's dirty, unofferable to the Lord. If somebody touches the ceiling and touches the coconut, gone, throw it, you know. So imagine what kind of devotion he is putting in. And when somebody puts in that kind of devotion in worshipping the Lord also puts in that kind of devotion in accepting it also here. So you find Ram is constantly telling Shabari, constantly eating those fruits with great intensity. And then Shabari is explaining to Ram after the whole episode of eating, which goes on for a prolonged duration of time. Shabari is talking to Lord Ram, and she tells him that my guru, Matang Rishi, he has told me that you will be coming here. And he told me this 13 years back. How many years back? 13 years back. And Matang Rishi, when he told her that Ram is going to come, you wait here till Ram comes. Matang Rishi and all his other disciples went back to the spiritual world. They winded up their pastimes and they left. And Shabari alone is here in the ashram with one instruction from the spiritual master. Ram will come. You serve him, then you come. Now, she didn't obviously tell me exactly which deity is coming. She didn't ask him, you know, from where he's going to come, you know. She didn't ask him any details. How many people are coming? No details. She only had the faith that Matang Rishi has told me Ram will come. He can come any day. So from that day onwards, every single day she would clean the ashram as if Ram is coming that day. She would pick fruits from the trees as if the Lord is coming that day. She would make garlands as if the Lord is coming that day. She was intensely preparing every single day as if Ram is coming that day. Now, enthusiasm has a limit for most people, you know. When they are enthusiastic in the beginning. But when you start having seasons of doubts, everyone has these seasons, you know, of doubts. When you start having seasons of doubts, that is when your enthusiasm decreases. But to be enthusiastic every single day for so many years without having an upper limit also. As in 13 years ke baad aane wale hi hai. Koi guarantee nahi hai. Absolutely no guarantee the Guru has given. But Shabari has faith that he has said means it will happen eventually. And that kind of certainty in the understanding that the spiritual master's words will manifest into reality eventually, that's the faith that Shabari showed. So now when Shabari is in front of Ram, he says, she is saying, today my faith in my spiritual master has even more solidified by seeing your presence. And she says, by the grace of the Guru, one attains the Supreme Lord. And the more important thing is, by the grace of the Supreme Lord, one reconnects back to the spiritual master. So, Ram, when he is hearing this discussion, if you notice, the discussion between Shabari and Ram is purely centered around Guru only. The entire discussion between Shabari and Ram, the whole discussion, how much ever time Ram was there in Shabari's ashram, they were only speaking about Matang Rishi, that's all. They didn't speak about the Supreme Lord at all, literally. You know. The discussion was completely centered around her Guru only. And that's very interesting from a devotional point of view. How important role the Lord gives the spiritual master's presence in our lives. So Ram asks Shabari, your spiritual master Matang Rishi seems to be a very interesting person. Can you tell me more about him? Imagine, the Lord is asking her, tell me more, you know. And for a disciple, what is more exciting than talking about your spiritual master? There is nothing more exciting, you know. And Shabari begins to speak about Matang Rishi's greatness. She tells that when I came into this ashram, the moment I entered in this area, there was some fragrance that attracted me here. And Ram and Lakshman could actually experience that fragrance in their ashram. And then Ram and Lakshman asked, where is this fragrance coming from? Shabari pointed out to some trees outside the ashram. And she says, these trees are the ones that have attracted me to this ashram. And she says, according to me, these trees are my Padapradakshak Guru. They are the ones who brought me to my spiritual master, you know. So anybody can be your Padapradakshak Guru, you know. For Shabari, it was two trees that became her Guru. Because the smell of those trees brought her to the ashram of Matang Rishi and she decided to stay here and dedicate her life. For all of us, different people are, you know, Padapradakshak Gurus. You know? Somebody gave us Prasad, he is our Guru, you know. Somebody gave us books, he becomes our spiritual master. Somebody gave us a garland, that person becomes our Padapradakshak Guru. So different people come in different ways. So then Ram asks her, what about these trees? She says that when I came into the ashram, that is the first question I asked my Guru. How are these trees so fragrant? And then Matang Rishi gave a very interesting answer. Matang Rishi gave a very coded answer. He said that this fragrance is a fragrance of devotional service. He said that and walked away. And then Shabari went and asked other disciples, why are the trees so fragrant? And then the disciples of Matang Rishi answered that once Matang Rishi saw some of his senior disciples carrying logs of wood from the forest. And they were sweating in the heat of the summer. And the sweat was dripping on the ground. And when Matang Rishi saw the sweat of these disciples and the way they were toiling for the sake of the Guru, he had tears in his eyes. And he blessed them that wherever their drops of sweat fall, their fragrant trees will grow. And from that day, fragrant trees have grown in that place. And these fragrant trees defeat all seasons. The flowers are blooming across the year. And the flowers don't fall also and wither away from the trees. And nobody picks up those flowers because they want everyone to come and experience. So Matang Rishi, he is so grateful to his disciples for their effort that he has blessed them to share that fragrance of the world. So the sweat that comes out when we serve the spiritual master, that sweat is very fragrant for the spiritual master and very fragrant for the Supreme Lord. It pleases the Lord. Now for us, when we see devotees sweating and you know We say it's so smelly, you know. There was a dancing in Kirtan, all smelly, smelly people around us, you know. So we are disgusted. But imagine how the spiritual master looks at this sweat. The spiritual master is so touched by the fact that these people have put so much effort, so much energy in trying to please him and trying to serve him. And that spiritual master blesses. And those blessings that come out from the heart of a spiritual master who has been pleased, those blessings are eternal. Those trees remain there forever. Disciples have gone, Matangarishi has gone, but the blessings still remain there. And then Ram was so impressed by, you know, this personality of Matangarishi. So then, you know, Shabari kept telling so many stories of Matangarishi's life. And Ram was really impressed with Matangarishi's personality. And as soon as Shabari, of course, after the whole discussion was over, there was this discussion about, you know, how he can find Sita. So Shabari tells him, go to the Rishimukh mountains where you'll find Sugriv. And Sugriv will help you find Sita. So now, Shabari herself has never seen Sita in her life. She herself has never seen Sita. Sita represents Bhakti Devi. She has not seen Sita, but she has the ability to give Ram direction to find Sita. Imagine, this grace of the spiritual master gives you the power to give direction to the Supreme Lord also. Shabari has just been following instructions of the spiritual master. And just because she has been following the instructions of the spiritual master, she has the ability to give direction to the Supreme Lord. Can you imagine? And not just that, the Supreme Lord actually follows what she said. That's even more interesting, you know. So which essentially means Bhakti Devi reciprocates and reveals herself to those devotees who actually selflessly serve the words of the spiritual master, selflessly serve the mission of the spiritual master. And here, you know, there's a lot of other discussions that happened between Shabari and Ram, all pertaining to Matangarishi. And at the end of the whole discussion, Shabari, she tells Lord Ram that, my dear Lord, I've been waiting 13 long years to rejoin my spiritual master, to reconnect with my spiritual master. Please give me blessings that I can go back and join him. Now Shabari is not telling him, can I remain in your service forever? Shabari is telling him, I have done what my spiritual master had told me to serve you. Now please let me go back and join him. So that means our deity worship is actually worship to the spiritual master only. And when we do deity worship, the reason we are doing deity worship is so that the deities can help us connect back to our spiritual master. So Ram, he actually assumed the Abhay Mudra. Throughout the Ramayana, Ram normally does the role of a human being. But there are two times in the Ramayana when, actually three times, when Ram assumes the Supreme Lord's mood. One is when Jatayu is being liberated. He actually gives him blessings to go back to the spiritual world. When Shabari is now asking for, you know, permission to go back, he gives her Abhay Mudra and he actually gives her blessings that she returns back to the spiritual master. And the third time when Vibhishan surrenders, there Ram shows his godhood. And Shabari, right in front of Lord Ram, she, you know, invokes a yogic fire and goes back to the abode of the spiritual master, right in presence of the Lord. So imagine how much the process of deity worship and guru worship is connected with each other. So here in this particular verse of the Bhagavatam which we are reading, so here Krishna uses the word Swagurum Mam Amayaya. He says here Swagurum is being translated here as his worshipable Lord. So now here the word Gurum in one sense is being considered as worshipable Lord means deity. But it also in another sense Gurum means the spiritual master. So there is a non-difference between the Lord and the spiritual master in this sense. There is a reciprocation between the Lord and the spiritual master. So when we are doing deity worship, it is non-different from guru worship. When you're doing guru worship, it is non-different from deity worship in that sense. Obviously, there is a gulf of difference between guru and the spiritual master, but their aims are same. The aims are very much same. When you approach the deities, the deity inspires you to take shelter of the spiritual master. And when you approach the spiritual master inspires you to take shelter of the deities. And therefore, this whole reciprocation of Shabari plays a very important role in us understanding what is the mood of deity worship. So as I said, Krishna is speaking to Uddhava here about the importance of doing deity worship. And in the Ramayana, Ram is showing how important it is and what is the mood of doing deity worship. Hare Krishna. I'll stop here. I'm actually running a little bit because I need to reach somewhere in some time, so we won't have any questions. But before I end, I would like to say this session, whatever I spoke today, if there's anything that has helped you all in your appreciation of the spiritual master and understanding the process of deity worship, please give me your blessing so that I can also inculcate that in my own lives. If there's anything I've said that is beyond my realizations, please forgive me for that. Thank you very much. And let us all pray that we attain shelter of the spiritual master through the medium of deity worship, through Radha Gopinath's seva. And we attain the worship of Radha Gopinath through the worship of the spiritual master. Thank you very much. Grantra Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki.
Hare Krishna, there is an announcement. Varisht Vaishnava meeting in Bhakti Siddhant Hall will take place today at 10:30 a.m. Today's speaker is His Grace Vrishabhanu Prabhu.